Raise your hand, I'll get Mr. Ed to flip on down the aisle. All right, Mr. Ed? All right. Just raise your hand so we can get that there. I got a lot of hands raised now. You got this flipped, Mr. Ed. I don't see you flipping yet. He's flipping his mind. All right. Let me go ahead and do something now so we don't just end the service. We're trying to cut out any announcement into the service. Just as you hear the word of God, to let God's word speak and not be interrupted by me telling you about stuff. So let me tell you about some stuff right now. Real quick. All right, just a few things. The DAPCO Missions winter trip application is available online or from Betty and Anita. No money is due. The office will send that when it's supposed to. But if you have any questions or interest in going to Navajo for the Christmas trip, see Anita or Betty. Anita's in the sanctuary, Betty's in the building right now. Also, after the service today, we have a question answered for our budget. All discussion is today, and we vote on next week with no discussion. So you want to be here for that. Deacon ordination councils tonight at 6:30 after everything's over tonight. So you want to be here for deacons, ordained men, you want to be here for that. This next Wednesday night, we have a special guest speaker coming in that will speak to the youth and adults. It's Pastor Frankie from Brazil. I mean, excuse me, Belize, from Belize. And so you don't want to miss that. We've been trying to get him here on Sunday night and everything didn't work out. He will be here this Wednesday night, Pastor Frankie from Belize. He'll tell us about what the floor has been trying to tell us about for a long time. We're going to just talk to him about some of that. He'll be sharing with us. Also, Wednesday night, because of a dinner that we're trying to have, there are 23 people signed up for dinner. They don't want to, they're doing hamburgers. They would like to get a good count. So if you can call the church office, see Miss Suzanne or see Miss Marge and let them know so we can get a good count there. And also, last thing, Alan, I'm going to turn it back over to you. Best recall business meeting next Sunday night after the service at 6 o'clock. We'll be voting on the budget. We'll be voting on nominating committee stuff for our leadership this next year. And we'll be voting for this gentleman in the back that's been running the sound for us for a few weeks for him to be officially in that position. That's the only thing to be discussed at that business meeting. It's a special call business meeting that week. I think that's it. We don't have to do this afterwards, right? All right. Let's just worship the Lord. God is good.
All
and all the time.
God is good.
I did do this one.
You did this one?
Yes.
I went to sleep. Let's stand up and let's stand up, turn around, and shake the hands of the people around you. There's a ring up here like crazy.
Yeah.
Father, now and bless him, I seek inflicted upon the leaders of our nation. Lord, I pray, Heavenly Father, you bless them. Pray, Lord, you bless our soldiers who are in harm. I ask you, Heavenly Father, to watch over them and keep them safe. I ask you, Heavenly Father, now to come to the part where we give back a portion of what you bless us with. I pray, Heavenly Father, you bless the giver, bless those who have not to give. Bless the pastor, he stands before us and breaks a bit of life, Lord. I pray your blessing upon him. I pray, Lord, that you bless his congregation. Bless our upcoming meetings, at least out east aspect of this church. I pray your blessing upon it. Let your Holy Spirit dwell among us today, that we'll know that we worship you and praise your name, and you're here. Of course, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
1 says this: Be gracious to me, O God, according to the greatness of thy compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquities, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in thy sight, so that thou art justified when thou dost speak, and blameth when thou dost judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, thou dost desire truth in an innermost being, and in the hidden parts thou wilt make me know wisdom. Purify me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which thou hast broken rejoice. Hide thy face from my sin, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. If you're willing and able, you can deal with me in the prayer. Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we have sang about the beautiful one, Lord. Celebrate Jesus, celebrate life's all. Lord, and then I read the Psalm of David. Psalm where, Lord, he is confessing to you, Lord, that he needs your mercy, he needs your grace, he needs your compassion. Lord, there's not one person in this place that doesn't need those things. Lord, because of sin, we are separated from God. Because of Jesus Christ, when we celebrate, Lord, we can be right with him again. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that you sent your Son Jesus to die on the cross for the forgiveness of sin. Lord God, help us to realize, Lord God, that you're the only one that can provide mercy. Lord, you're the only one, Lord, that can make us clean. Lord God, that we are sinners in need of a Savior, Lord God. Lord, that, Lord, even though, Lord, for us that are believers, Lord God, we still sin. And we still need to seek forgiveness, Lord God, when we sin. Lord, but you are faithful and just to forgive us of those things. Lord, we celebrate that, Lord God. We should shout that to the rooftops, Lord, what Jesus has done for us. Lord, the Bible says, Lord, that he could do no sin, became sin for us, that we might be the righteousness of God for him. Lord, we thank you for that, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you didn't leave us to ourselves and our sins and our trespasses. Lord, as David said, create in me a clean heart and renew a steadfast spirit within me, Lord God. Lord, if there's anyone in this place that needs to do that, Lord God, that needs your forgiveness, Lord God, I pray they'll seek that out. Lord, I pray that the word of God is preached this morning, Lord God, it will pierce hearts. Lord, that the word of God will be like a double-edged sword. And Lord God, that it will do what you have sent out to accomplish to do. Lord God, that through your word this morning, Lord God, people will come to salvation. Through your word this morning, Lord God, people will know other areas of their lives, Lord God, where they need to seek forgiveness of sins, to celebrate that victory in Jesus they get, Lord God, from confessing. Lord, that victory they get, Lord God, it comes from your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. Lord, I thank you for him. Lord, I thank you for all that you do. Lord, speak to us, Lord God, from your word.
Than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Good morning. If you would please turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. We are getting back into the Sermon on the Mount today. I have tried and tried to get back in this over the past, I guess really the past month, and God has just not let me. It's amazing how the Holy Spirit works in that way. But nevertheless, we are back today, and we'll stay here for as long as God will continue to let us work through these passages. I am continuously amazed at the depth of these texts. When you try to get into these and start working them out, you quickly become aware of how deep they are and how profound the words of our Lord really are. As I started thinking through this one, I started thinking about relationships. And when we came in earlier this morning and we saw the people coming in, you see people hugging one another and talking with one another, which we certainly did the same, I was just reminded again about relationships and how important they are in everyone's life. Relationships are without a doubt one of the most precious gifts that God gives us this side of glory. And as humans, we are relational people. And I really don't have to tell anyone that. We know that. There is a desire in each person to live and do life alongside of others. I see these shows, and I don't know if you like to watch them, the Mountain Men shows, where these people go up in the mountains and they live all by themselves alone, and that's their goal, is to just totally be secluded from everyone. And I have to ask myself, as cool as this looks sometimes, are they really happy being away from people, or what are they maybe running from? Because everyone intrinsically needs other people in their life. I can look back over the landscape of my own life and clearly see both the positive and the negative influences that relationships have had in my own life, and I'm sure you can do the same. And some people are more prone to want to be around people, and then others not so much. But even introverts, as we know, people that kind of shy away from crowds, they don't want to be up in the middle of people, even they still need to live life with and around others. And really the core reason for that, why we are such relational people, is that we were created by a relational God. We must not ever forget that. The one true and living God, the God of the Bible, the triune God, has always existed in a perfect relationship as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that's, we draw our relational need back to that core doctrine of Scripture. Relationships are so important to us, and it's because they're important to God. It was His original plan that we live life within community. And that is why the local church is such an important and necessary gift and should never, ever be taken lightly. The relationships God forms within a local body of believers, they have powerful connections that we know that shape our life in one way or another. Dr. Bruce Ware, one of my theology professors at the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, wrote this, and I quote, "God intends that there be a created community of persons in which there is an interconnection and interdependence so that what one does affects another. What one needs can be supplied by another, and what one seeks to accomplish may be assisted by another." And that's certainly true. And if you really think about it, as we've been moving through the Sermon on the Mount, relationships have really been an underlying theme in everything that we've talked about. Just for a quick review, since we haven't been there for a while, in chapter 5, verses 2 through 12 of Matthew, Jesus taught us what the characteristics of a genuine believer look like. Apart from God, they are spiritually bankrupt, knowing they cannot save themselves by works. They are grieved over their own sinful nature. They are humble towards God and His authoritative word. Their number one desire in life is to be more like Jesus' nature and less like their own every day. They show mercy to others because they realize how merciful that God has been with them. They're positionally holy because of what God has done for them through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And because of all this, they are guaranteed persecution from the world to some degree because of their relationship with God through Christ. That's the Beatitudes. Next, we saw in verses 13 through 16, we saw how a Christian influences everything and everyone around them by being salt and light to a very dark and decaying world in which we find ourselves. And our union with Christ affects our worldly relationships in this life. In verses 17 through 20, Jesus explained his relationship with the law and our relationship with the law in light of what Christ has done. And then in verse 20, Christ made the statement that really the rest of everything in the Sermon on the Mount hinges on, and that is, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. See, Jesus is driving home the truth that an outward display of religion is not enough to personally know God. Only by the righteousness of Christ attributed to a repentant sinner through faith in Him provides restoration and that right relationship with God. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 5:21, "For our sake He made Him who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God." It's because of Christ and what He has done allows anyone to be in a right relationship with their Creator. So as we move into this new section of the Sermon on the Mount, what Jesus is going to do is He's going to start focusing on personal relationships with one another. Starting here in verse 21 and running all the way through verse 48, Jesus is going to give us six examples of what practical righteousness resulting from our positional righteousness in Christ looks like worked out with those that are closest to us. This is where Christianity gets real, folks. This is where it gets up close and personal with anyone that claims to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. He's going to show us how practical righteousness works its way out in our homes, in the bedroom, at the dinner table, in the church, around friends, and at the workplace. Because Jesus wants us to live righteously within every single relationship that we have. Now, someone is not made up, or they're not made a Christian by the way they act or behave. And I want to make that very clear right off the bat. These are not just moral lessons that if we'll just do this and we'll really try, that's going to put us in the right relationship with God. That's not what these six examples are showing us. Just because someone may strive to do what's right doesn't make them right with God. Paul says in Ephesians 2, 8 through 9, "For grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing." You can take pride in works and you can throw it in the trash can. It's not going to work. Salvation is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. See, what Jesus wants us to see is that Christians should act and behave in certain ways because they have been saved. Now, it's a work in progress. Every one of us know that. And that's going to become really, really clear over the next few weeks as we go through this. But if there isn't even a desire or a drive or a moving or a pulling to act in the way Jesus is going to show us, then you may not be truly converted at all. And that needs to resonate with everyone here. Over the next few weeks, we're going to look at what Jesus says concerning anger and reconciliation. That's what we're going to talk about today. He's going to talk about lust and purity, divorce, truthfulness, revenge, and loving others. And these aren't easy topics to deal with. But if we're going to reflect the type of righteousness that Christ wants us to have in the relationships that we've been blessed with, then we're going to have to hit these topics head on. So if you would stand, we're going to read Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 26. As we begin today looking at these ways that righteousness works itself out in relationships. Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 26. You have heard it. You have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny." Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this morning, sinful people, in desperate, desperate need of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Father, only through his righteousness, only because of his completed work on the cross, only because of his shed blood, do we stand here today, holy and blameless in your sight. Father, you have made us through Christ positionally holy. And we don't stop and thank you for that nearly enough. But Father, your word goes farther than that. It doesn't call us to just claim Jesus and put life in neutral. Father, your word tells us that being that we have been grafted into your family, that we are to act like we are in your family. We all fall short of it, but Father, we look to Christ for strength, we look to the Spirit for guidance, and we look to you and your promises that you will enable us to live in a way that you find worthy. So God, we need grace over the next few weeks. We need grace starting right now as we go through your word, Father. And I pray that you would convict hearts where they need to be convicted. And Father, I pray that we would see our relationships as important as you do. So God, give us strength this morning. Fill this place with your Spirit. And Father, give us the strength to obey where we need to. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. If you're taking an outline, the first point this morning we're going to look at is the issue with anger. The issue with anger. Jesus begins in verse 21 by simply quoting the sixth commandment. And this is found in Exodus chapter 20, verse 13, "You shall not murder." Now, he is not discounting this law. He's not saying that it no longer matters. In fact, what he is doing is he is raising the bar of the law back to where it needs to be. His intent is to force us to look beyond just the letter of the law, which is the literal interpretation of the words. But he wants us to look more into the spirit of the law. And that's where the principles come into play that are behind the words. This is what the Pharisees had absolutely lost touch with. They were caught up in externally fulfilling just the letter of the law and their traditions. And they have forgotten the original principles and the original meaning and original foundation of God's moral law. And as a result of that, the complete meaning of these things had become obscure to the people that had heard it. In fact, Jesus' main priority in verses 21 through 48 is to rightly interpret and fully restore the laws that they were familiar with. That's one of his main principles that we're going to see as we move forward. Look with me for just a second. Follow along. Drop down to verse 27. This is Jesus on purity. You notice he says, "For you have heard that it was said," and then Jesus says, "But I say to you." Look in verse 31. Jesus on divorce. "It was also said, but I say." Verse 33 on truthfulness. Again, "You have heard it was said to those of old, but I say." Verse 38 on revenge. "You've heard that it was said, but I say to you." Verse 43 on love. Jesus says, "You have heard it was said, but I say to you." Jesus is simply explaining the true nature of the law over and against what the Pharisees had been teaching over the centuries. And just kind of from a historical standpoint, the condition of the Jews in Christ's day was very similar to Christians before the Protestant Reformation, which, by the way, this year we're going to celebrate the 500th year anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And God willing, we're going to talk more about that in October, because that is something that every believer needs to know more about. But before the late 1500s, the Bible was not translated into English, but read in Latin to people who didn't understand Latin. Imagine that. Because of this, they were entirely dependent upon what the priest tried to explain. And nobody knew if what they were hearing was even right. And what the people were hearing coming out of the Catholic Church at the time was a false gospel mixed with church tradition. It's what they were being fed week in and week out. Now, the Reformation gave the Bible back to the people so they could read it themselves, and by the illumination of the Holy Spirit, we can understand it correctly. If you're indwelled by the Holy Spirit, you don't necessarily need me up here explaining to you exactly what this means. Now, God calls preachers and pastors to do that, but every one of you in here have the ability to pick up the Bible, and by the illumination of the Holy Spirit, you can understand it. You should be able to. And with the resources that we have available to us today, you certainly don't have an excuse not to. I had someone tell me the other day that as I preach, they're fact-checking me in the back. I praise God for that. Amen. That's awesome. That's good stuff. We're like a bunch of Bereans, always looking to see if what's true and correct, but I praise God for that. But the Jews in Christ's day were in a very similar situation to the Christians before the Protestant Reformation. During Israel's captivity in Babylon, they had all but lost their native Hebrew language. The language when they came back was Aramaic and began to be more Greek influenced. Since they were no longer familiar with Hebrew, they had a hard time reading the law of Moses. And the result was they were dependent on the twisted teachings of the scribes and the Pharisees. You see the similarity here? What they heard was incomplete interpretation of God's word attached with traditions that had been added over the centuries. And this led to a very, very, very shallow understanding of God's word. What it really did was it led to just a list of do's and don'ts. And all of us know it's really easy sometimes to follow a list of do's and don'ts. But if you get down to the spirit of law and what the principles are, now that's a different thing altogether. Jesus corrects this. His words, "but I say," in each of these sections is Jesus claiming the authority of God himself. It's like he's saying, "I'm the one who gave the law to Moses, and because of that, I have every right to interpret it the way I want to." I don't care what your culture says. I don't care what your leaders say. Here is what I say. Jesus is literally saying, "Thus saith the Lord." So back to our text. In this passage, in verse 21 through 26, Jesus takes this shallow teaching of do not murder and he expands it back to what it's supposed to mean. He gets back to the spirit of the law and declares that sinful anger, the root cause of all murder, deserves the same judgment as killing someone. Uh-oh. I'm sure someone sitting by that sermon said the same thing when they heard it. Here again, Jesus, these words would have shocked the crowds because the Pharisees taught that someone could be righteous just as long as they had never really physically killed anyone. That's what it had been reduced to. Now, let's bring this home for a second. Most people think like that. We turn on the news and we see a murderer on trial and we think, man, we're better than they are because we've never killed anybody. We see the leaders of other countries killing their own people and we think, wow, I'm surely not evil like they are. We see people who celebrate abortion and we think, wow, certainly I'm more innocent than they are. See, this is the attitude of self-righteousness that Jesus wants to absolutely shatter and tear down. And he does so right here by teaching us that murder is simply a symptom of an angry heart. And both are equally as bad in the eyes of God. Now, Jesus is going to break this teaching down in a few very simple concepts, okay? So I want us to see them. And the first thing Jesus wants us to see is this. Number A, letter A, anger becomes dangerous when left unresolved. Anger becomes dangerous when it's left unresolved. Look back in verse 22. Whoever is angry with his brother will be liable to the judgment. Now, it's important to note that Jesus is not forbidding all types of anger. God gets angry. He is a God of both love and wrath. And wow, the church has totally forgotten that at large today. We want to focus so much on God's love, which we should. The Bible is very clear. God is love. God so loved the world that he sent Christ, that whosoever would believe in him should not ever perish but have everlasting life. But God is also a God of wrath. He is a God that hates sin. It's obvious all through the Old Testament. If there is anything that makes God angry, it's idolatry towards him and injustice towards others. And next time you read through the Old Testament, you take that thought with you and look, every time God is angry, it's because of idolatry or injustice towards others. So it's only natural that several times in the New Testament, being that Jesus is God, the exact representation of the Father, it's only natural that we see him being described as angry through the New Testament. In Mark chapter 3, verses 4 through 5, Jesus is in the synagogue and the Pharisees are watching. Man, they're watching him, seeing what he's going to do to see if he's going to heal a man on the Sabbath. And they wanted to accuse him of breaking their oral traditions. And he said to them, "Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save life or to kill?" But they were silent. And he looked around at them with anger, grieved at the hardness of their heart. There are other examples of Christ being what we'll call righteously angry. Mark 10, Jesus became angry when the disciples turned the children away from coming to him. His anger was certainly on display in Mark 11 when he overturned the tables in the temple. So obviously there is a type of righteous anger towards sin and injustice. And perhaps, just perhaps, Christians in today's world need to be a little more angry over the sin that we see all around us instead of embracing it like so many do. How can you be Christ-like if you do not get angry over sin? There's a major disconnect if that's not happening. But, and this is a big but, for sinful people, there is always a danger in taking anger too far. We're not God. Our anger is not always going to be righteous. And if you'll just stop and think for a minute, there are probably times when you really thought, and maybe it was, your anger was righteous in its actions, but how quickly did it become sinful? Paul says in Ephesians 4:26 through 27, "Be angry and do not sin." Man, that's hard to do. "Do not let the sun go down on your anger and give no opportunity to the devil." So what type of anger is Jesus talking about here? He says in verse 22a, "Whoever is angry with his brother is liable to the judgment." Jesus is talking about anger with others over personal offenses. This is a selfish anger against someone who has maybe irritated or displeased you. Does that ever happen to anybody? This is anger that goes unchecked, unresolved, under the surface. It's kind of like if you go camping and you put the fire out at night. You brush some leaves and stuff over it. Those coals are still hot enough the next morning that if it gets a little air, it's going to flame up again. This is an anger that refuses to let go because of pride and egos. Well, I don't deserve that. It's an anger that refuses to forgive. This type of anger resents others and does not even try to make things right. This type of anger is even more damaging between Christian brother or sisters. Notice in the verse, Jesus says, "Whoever's angry with his brother," because think of the silliness behind that. To remain angry at someone when you have been forgiven through Christ and been relieved of the anger that God has towards your sin. Jesus is saying that this type of anger is the root of all murderous actions. Therefore, it is just as sinful as murder is in killing someone. Look at B. Anger becomes destructive when we criticize others. Anger becomes destructive when we criticize others. Look at verse 22b. Jesus says, "Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council." Now, some of your translations use the word raka. I think I said that all right, raka. This word was really a kind of a quasi-swear word in Christ's day. And what it means is idiot or worthless. Some of your translations may say good for nothing. I think the NAS says that. But it was these types of words, idiot, worthless, good for nothing, trash, that would have been used by the soldiers who participated in Christ's crucifixion. How often do we criticize others when we totally don't understand their motives? How quick are we to slander people when we don't have all of the information about maybe what is going on? How quick are we to mock people when we really don't know them very well? See, I don't want to get too specific here because I just kind of want the Spirit to bring to your mind whatever it happens to be that you find yourself in this position, because we are all guilty of this. to some degree or another. See, we often forget the damage that our words can cause. One commentator puts it like this, and I quote, "To slander a creature made in God's image is to slander God himself and is equivalent to murdering that person." Contempt, Jesus says, is murder of the heart, unquote. Let's look at C. Anger becomes destructive. Anger becomes deadly when we condemn others. Do you see the progression here? Anger becomes deadly when we condemn others. Verse 22c says, "And whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire." Now, fool comes from the word moros. And it's obvious we get the word moron from that. And it means stupid. And this is really interesting, and I didn't know this until I studied through here, but in Christ's time, this word would have really meant someone who was godless. Someone that had no faith, no authority to God. No, they did not find themselves under God's authority. They were a godless individual. See, what we have here now is a picture of increasing anger, unresolved anger, that's the root of a murderous heart. There was mocking and criticism, slander, possibly behind someone's back. And here we see this unresolved, unchecked anger that spills out with emotion. And this type of angry, hateful language can absolutely kill someone's character and destroy their confidence. It's assassination by words. And maybe you say, well, hang on. You know, we joke around like that all the time. Maybe you youth, that comes to mind. You joke around like this all the time, right? What's the harm? I mean, they know I'm not serious when I call them things like this. All right, well, here's what Paul says in Ephesians 4:29. "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up as fits the occasion, that may give grace to those who hear." We need to stop taking for granted that our words may not hurt the people that they're directed to. They do. Read James. Words kill. They hurt. They can't be taken back. And let me just, if I may, stop for a second and really get relevant to the time in which we find ourselves. Do we not realize that when we make comments and write things on social media, that it's the same thing as saying it to someone to their face? It's speech. It's speech. When we send a text, or we shoot an email, or we criticize someone on Facebook, or Instagram, or Snapchat, or whatever it may be that I'm not quite hip enough to know about. I'm sure there is something. But whatever it may be, speech is speech. Words are words. And if you really want to go far enough, the words that you type and use on social media, they can never be taken back. Well, here's another argument about this. This comes up, talking about calling somebody fools and whatnot. What about Paul, you might ask? What about Paul in Galatians 3:1 when he writes to the Galatian church and says, "You fools"? Or Jesus in Matthew 23:17 when he calls the scribes and Pharisees fools? You say, well, hang on. Is that a contradiction? Not at all. See, in both of these instances, God's word is condemning other sinful behavior. That's the main difference there, okay? Paul is calling out the Galatians from turning from the gospel, and Jesus is condemning the Pharisees of not being justified in God's sight. He's literally calling them godless, and they were. But these two examples should make us even more cautious of ever condemning anyone by calling them a fool or a moron. So what about you? What about your relationships? Is there anger towards someone else, or do you know if someone else is angry towards you, maybe of something that's been said or something that's been done? Are there broken relationships, things that need mending? If so, and here's the good news, and if you're in Christ, then there's grace. There's grace. Because the grace of God has shown, because of the grace that God has shown you, He wants you to extend the same grace to others. The next thing I want us to see is point number two, the importance of reconciliation within your relationships. The importance of reconciliation within your relationships. Jesus gives us two illustrations of how and why we should seek reconciliation with anyone that has an issue with us. And you may ask, well, what if I have an issue with someone else? How do I reconcile with those that have wronged me? Well, that's the easy part. You just forgive them and you move on. Ephesians 4:32 says, "Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you." But this is what we are to do in situations where someone has an issue with us, for whatever reason it might be. Maybe they're justified in being upset with you and there's a conflict. Maybe they're not justified in having an issue. For whatever reason, God is calling us to some very practical steps of trying to mend and restore and reconcile our relationships. We'll first look at the how. How should we restore our relationships? There's three steps. How should we restore our relationships? Look in verse 23. "So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember," underline remember, "and there remember that your brother has something against you." Step number one. Don't disregard who the Spirit shows you. Don't disregard who the Spirit shows you. See, as believers, we need to stop and think, is there anyone that may feel that I have wronged them in some way? Is there anyone out there I need to deal with? Now, I find this especially the case when someone was maybe saved later in life. There's probably a lot of water under your bridge. Maybe. Maybe you haven't seen this person in years. Maybe you haven't talked to them. But when you stop and think about it, and you ask the Holy Spirit, "God, bring to mind who it may be that I have an issue with," don't disregard it. And if you haven't talked to them in a while, what an awesome opportunity it would be to show them and tell them what Christ has done in your own life. Because I guarantee you, if you call somebody or go to them after years and say, "Look, I know that you think that I have wronged you in some way," that's going to shock them that you did that. Because that is not the natural way that sinful people conduct themselves within relationships. Whoever the Spirit brings to mind, that's who you need to deal with. Don't disregard it in thinking, "Oh, that was so long ago, it doesn't matter now." Or, "Oh, they know I didn't mean anything by that." Or, "I'm sure they've probably gotten over it. After all, they were nice to my face last time I saw them." whoever it is that God puts on your mind, you need to seek them out for restoration. That's step one. Don't disregard who the Spirit shows you. Next, look in verse 24a. Leave your gift there before the altar and go. Leave your gift there before the altar and go. Number two, don't delay when the Spirit leads you. Don't delay when the Spirit leads you. See, if God is gracious and you think of this person that has an issue with you, then stop what you're doing and go. This is going to take swallowing your pride. It's going to be uncomfortable. It's going to be awkward. It might be very awkward. But pick up the phone or get in your vehicle. The key point is to be intentional. You go to that person. Don't delay. Next, look at verse 24b. First be reconciled with your brother, and then come back and offer your gift. Step three, don't discount how the Spirit convicts you. Don't discount whatever way it is or whatever the Spirit tells you to do. Don't get so caught up in your day and in your schedule that you're like, man, I don't have time to deal with that. I can't rearrange everything to do what I need to do. Well, maybe God does want you to totally rearrange your life and get out of your comfort zone and reschedule and reprioritize everything you have so that you can go to that person and restore what's been broken. You say, surely the Spirit wouldn't convict me to do all that and overturn everything just to go tell that person that I'm sorry for whatever it is that they think that I might have done. Don't discount how the Spirit convicts you. We should move around whatever we need to move around to make time to think and go after others in hopes of mending relationships. That's the how. That's the how. But why? Why should we want to restore our relationships? Well, number one, and this right here would have blown the Pharisees' minds. Number one, because God is more concerned with our relationships than our ritualistic worship. Because God is more concerned with our relationships than He is with our ritualistic worship. See, if you look at verses 23 and 24, this is a picture of worship. We've been talking about leaving a gift on the altar, thinking about things during the service, leaving your gift on the altar, going back out, coming back. And the Jews would have put extraordinary emphasis on temple worship. In other words, they were like a lot of us. Their life was centered around church. They prayed, they tithed, they sacrificed. But so much of it was heartless ritual. In the so, or therefore, here in verse 23, refers back to all the murderous anger that Jesus talked about. And he's saying, basically, if any of that is in your heart, then your worship is worthless. Get up. Leave your sacrifice. Leave your tithe. Stop praying and go make things right with those who you've wronged and then come back and worship. See, God is serious about the condition of our relationships. So we should make every effort to fix whatever is broken. Second reason why. Number two. Because He can and will judge us accordingly if we don't. Because he can and he will judge us accordingly if we don't. Look at verse 25 through 26, and I'll just read it again real quick. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. So this is a picture of an out-of-court settlement between two litigants. And really, this is great advice. This is great practical advice to settle a dispute with someone that has something against you. But see, this passage goes way deeper than just that. This person is being taken to court because they have sinned against someone else. This person has rightly done someone wrong here. And if it's not resolved quickly, before the appointed time of court, they're going to face whatever penalty the judge declares. And the point is that we're to make every effort, with no delay, to make our relationships right with others before our relationships can be right with God. In other words, settle it this side of heaven, not at God's judgment seat. See, sometimes, as we all know, even if you are faithful, even if you say, you know what, I'm going to pray, I'm going to go, I'm not going to delay, I'm going to prioritize everything so I can go do what I got to do, the Bible still does not guarantee you that if you do all of this, that whoever you've wronged is going to say, you know what, it's cool, it's fine, I forgive you. There's no guarantee here. Paul told the Romans that if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peacefully with all. And this implies that it won't always be possible to fix broken relationships. But God is commending us to try. He's commending us to try. See, the truth is, no one at any time has the perfectly right attitude towards others. And none of us worship in a way that is completely right in God's eyes. Because everything we do, even our best motives, is still tainted with sin for us to try to get some kind of glory out of what we're doing ourselves. In other words, whatever we do, we're not going to be able to get all of ourselves out of it. Our best attempts are flawed by our own sin. And this is just the first teaching of five that's going to reveal how far short we fall. And it shatters any type of self-righteousness that we think we have, because every one of us here today have killed with an angry heart. That is why we look to Jesus and His righteousness. That is why we look to the cross. That is why we look to Christ and we say, my faith is in what He did, not in what I can do. That's what the beauty of the gospel is. That we realize how far short we fall in all of our relationships, and we look to the one that got it all right. Only in Christ will our attempts at reconciliation become acceptable to the one who sets the standard. Let's stand and pray. Father God, we thank you for Christ and His righteousness. Oh, how we should say that repeatedly, over and over and over every day. Father, because when we hold up the mirror of your word and look into it and see our own life, we realize how far we fall short. Father, we look to Christ and we trust in Him and His righteousness alone. But Father, we need the Holy Spirit to guide us so that we may live in a way that's pleasing to You, that we may live in a way that honors the gospel, that we may live in a way that others would look at us and say, wow, what's different about them? And then we have an opportunity to share our faith in Christ and what He's done on our behalf. So God, I don't know the hearts of Your people today. You do. Father, I don't even know my own heart as well as I should, but You do. So God, I simply ask this morning that You give us strength to do what we need to do. Father, I pray that if this message, if You've used it in some small way to draw someone to Christ, Father, if they recognize their own sinful predicament, that today would be the day that they would repent and place their faith in what Christ has done and not what they can do. Father, I pray that You'd save someone today and You'd give them the boldness to step out and proclaim that. Father, maybe you're dealing with someone about joining the church or following Christ in obedient baptism. Father, I pray this would be the morning that You would guide them to do just that. Whatever Your word proclaims, Father, whatever You would have Your people do, I pray they would do it now in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is my desire to honor You, Lord, with all my heart, I worship You. All I have within I'm away.